The Spy Wore Red by Aline, Countess of Romanones. The book bears a dedication. For Luis. For Luis, my husband. For Luis, my son. For Luis, my grandson. If the Red Slayer thinks he slays, or if the slain think he is slain, they know not well the subtle ways I keep and pass and turn again. Ralph Waldo Emerson, Brahma. Author's note. In the course of lecturing over the past 8 years, I've discovered that people enjoy, and need, authentic first-hand information about espionage, a topic on which reliable information is, understandably, difficult to come by. What I have attempted in this book is to inform and to entertain. My guideposts have been the events themselves, as well as I can reconstruct them from memory and from diaries, letters, snapshots, newspapers, and magazines of the period. There are, however, three limitations on the literal truthfulness of my memoir. In the first place, many of the principles of the drama I recount are living and might conceivably be embarrassed or otherwise inconvenienced by my account of their activities. In order to protect their privacy, then, I have changed the names of some of the characters in the story. And in a very few cases where a name change did not sufficiently conceal a character's identity, a composite character was created. The man I call Pierre has been disguised, I hope, as has the man codenamed Mozart. But there was a Pierre, and there was a Mozart, as there were, in some fashion, all the others. Secondly, I have occasionally omitted or altered insignificant incidents that would otherwise bore the reader and make the book cumbersome and dreary. Again, this has resulted in a composite character now and then, and in some cases the sequence of events has been slightly altered. The core of the story is accurate. Finally, my efforts to reconstruct this period of my life from memory have been more successful than I had originally expected, but of course not perfect. Various documents, including reports and cables stored in the National Archives in Washington, D.C., have been of great help in refreshing my memory. But much of the dialogue in the book has been reinvented based on recollection. My intention throughout has been to capture the essence and flavor of the events and conversations that took place. If I have succeeded in doing that, the courage and dedication of my colleagues and the excitement of the time will speak for themselves. Prologue, San Salvador, 1984. It was a trip to El Salvador several years ago that started this story. I had been lecturing on foreign affairs throughout the United States. At that moment, Central America and especially El Salvador were the areas my audiences were most interested in. But to be truthful, my motives for making the trip derived mainly from an unquenchable desire to be in the middle of whatever was going on. The fact that it would be warm and sunny there, in comparison to the ice and snow of Michigan where I happened to be, and that I could eat mangoes might also have been a factor. At any rate, I indulged myself with the excuse that the visit would add credibility to my lectures. The trip had ingredients that appealed to my sense of adventure. For example, I didn't know the name, telephone number, or even the sex of the person who would meet me or where I would be staying. Arrangements had been made hastily through a telephone call to a Salvadoran friend in Washington, who offered to find a private house where I could stay, and friends who would take care of my needs. Since I had only a week free between lectures, he suggested I leave for Salvador immediately. "I'll have someone meet you at the airport who'll explain all the details," he said. From the moment I boarded the plane in New York, I was, without being aware of it at first, on a trip back in time. That feeling took over in Miami, where passengers crammed on board with their belongings in cloth sacks, looking very much as the passengers had on Spanish trains in 1944. In Panama, many disembarked, and in Tegucigalpa, almost all left. Our destination was now only minutes away. I looked down at the lush green valleys rolling into the volcanic mountain ranges, which I knew harbored guerrilla groups, some at that moment in skirmishes with soldiers of the country's armed forces. Only one other passenger got off the large DC-10 to enter the empty modern air terminal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.